Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jeff Brown, and I work for Pivotal. I work on the Grails development team. And what I'm going to be talking about this afternoon is RESTful Grails 2. So I'm going to cover a lot of fundamental stuff provided by the framework that is related to building REST services and exposing REST services. So I'm going to cover, as I said, lots of the fundamentals. There are a couple of other related talks this week. Tomorrow morning at 8:30, Ken Cousin has another RESTful Grails talk that there's some overlap between this session and that one, but he's going to cover some things like hypermedia and a few important topics that did not make it into the agenda for this session. So keep an eye out for that tomorrow if you want to learn a little bit more than we cover today. There'll be some of that tomorrow. How many of you are using Grails 2? Yeah, almost everyone. How many building RESTful services, publishing RESTful services from inside of your Grails app? Yeah, about half. That's good. When you do that, are you exposing interfaces or endpoints that accept and return JSON? Is that the primary format of data coming out? So all the heads are going up and down? Okay. All right. Very good. That'll help me kind of tailor some things as we move along here. Yep. All right. So REST. REST is really an architectural style. REST is not a particular piece of software. It's a style of coordinating communication between systems. For a long time, really since the very beginning, Grails has had support for REST. Of course, the framework doesn't, strictly speaking, have to provide any specific REST features in order to support REST. Right? If you can receive an HTTP request and parse the parameters and the body of the request, and then send a response that might be structured as JSON or XML, technically you're publishing REST services. It turns out that Grails provides, and Grails 2 in particular, introduced a lot of really, really cool stuff to really simplify and clean up applications that are that want to do that sort of thing. So that's a lot of what we're going to cover today. So I'm going to talk about, this is really just kind of a subset of some of the high-level items that we're going to cover. We're going to talk about URL mappings, some really cool, sophisticated stuff that the data binding system in Grails 2 supports. In Grails 2, we totally rewrote the data binding system. So prior to Grails 2, we had a pretty sophisticated and powerful data binding system that was built on top of Spring's data binder. And in Grails 2, we started from scratch and built a new data binding system from the ground up, and that allowed us to do a lot of the cool stuff that I'm going to talk about today. The Spring data binding system is still there. It's turned off by default, and there's a config setting you can express in your config.groovy file to turn that on. And that was important for maybe the first release or two, for the early releases of Grails 2, because we had written this a brand new data binding system, sort of as an escape hatch. If your application happened to have been doing something that the new data binding system didn't support yet, we wanted to provide a mechanism for you to still carry on and upgrade to Grails 2 and not let the new data binding system necessarily be a blocker to do that. And that was really the primary motivation for allowing folks to use the legacy data binder. The data binder is still in Grails 2.3 and Grails 2.4. It's deprecated and it's being removed in Grails 3. So if you're using if you're still using the Spring data binder for any reason, just know that that's one of the things you're going to have to address when you move to Grails 3, and probably should address it now anyway. So we'll talk about a lot that the data binding system has to offer. We'll talk about publishing data domain classes as resources. Turns out that's really, really simple to do in Grails 2. And we'll talk about customizing how a lot of this stuff works. We'll see how you can tailor the JSON or XML that gets rendered as part of the response or as the response. We'll talk about interacting with the data binding system to allow you to participate in a lot of what's going on there. So this is just a really simple domain class in a Grails app. So this would be under grails-app/domain. Looks like it's in the demo package. We've got a domain class that doesn't say anything at all about REST, doesn't say anything about representation at all. Just we've got a domain class that describes what a person looks like in our system. One way that I can provide access to that those person resources is I can provide a URL mapping that looks something like this. So notice /people happens to be the plural of person, but that can be any arbitrary string, right? What I'm saying here is that if a request comes into my application to the URL /people, I want that request, I'm expressing that that request should be handled by the person controller. So resources colon person, the person string there after resources corresponds to a controller name. And this mapping that you see there will work with the default generated scaffolding. So we haven't generated RESTful scaffolding or really done anything RESTful at all other than express the URL mapping that you're seeing here. If you've written the person class like this and you've generated the default scaffolding around that, this URL mapping will work and provide some interesting capabilities. So part of REST, HTTP request methods are an important part of how a lot of this stuff works. So when we define a mapping like this, what happens is really a bunch of mappings get created dynamically. The framework does this for you. And several of these all point to the same URL, but the requests sent to those URLs will be handled by potentially by different controller actions, and that's dictated by the HTTP request method. So for example, if you send a request to slash people, and it's a GET request, then by default, what that's going to do is execute the index action in the person controller. And then if we jump down two lines, if we send a POST request to slash people, that's going to execute the save action in the person controller, and so forth. So all of these mappings get created with just the one line of code that you see near the top there. The slash people, resources colon person, the mappings in the table there are all the result of defining that URL mapping. So prior to this support, which was added in Grails 2, you could do something like in your URL mappings, there we go. You could say something like access people, controllers person, and instead of saying something like action equals save, right, or action equals list or index, you can do that, right? And what that says is anytime a request comes into slash access people, I want that request to be handled by the index action in the person controller. Another thing you could do here is you could assign a map that says if this is a GET request, go to the list action. If it's a delete request, go to the delete action. So you can map different HTTP request methods to different controller actions using that syntax, right? So the same URL is being mapped to different controller actions based on the request method. So on line 7 there, the keys in the map correspond to HTTP request methods, and the values associated with those keys are the names of the actions that should be executed if a request is sent to slash access people with this particular HTTP request method. So that support has been in Grails for a long time. I don't remember what version of Grails we introduced that, but it was it certainly predates Grails 2. When you define when you use the syntax that you see on the slide here, you get that and really quite a bit more that that we're going to explore. So all of these mappings again are the results get created as the result of the one line in your URL mappings .Ruby file. And something that's not represented here is at the end of some of those URLs, you can express a content type. So let's take a look at that. Let me start this application up. And we'll send some requests to slash people and see what kind of responses we get. And in this application, I've created ahead of time that's relevant to what we're talking about is I've defined the person class, right? Got that. I've generated the default scaffolding. I haven't modified any of it. It's just exactly the result of running generate all demo.person. And I've defined this mapping in URL mappings.ruby. That's all I've got in place ahead of time. Instead of you watching me fumble typing curl commands, I'll copy and paste the curl command here. So I just sent a request to slash people. You can see that at the end of this URL. And it's a GET request. And I've expressed, I've added a header to the request that says, I would like to receive JSON back, right? So that's what we see. This is a JSON representation of all the person objects that are in the database right now. In my Bootstrap class, I've got some code that's creating these person objects. It's where that data came from. So I sent a request to slash people. It's a GET request. And there's an accept header that says, that expresses what kind of data I want back. I want JSON back, so that's why we see JSON there. If I change that accept header and ask for XML, we'll get that, right? So we get XML back. And notice we haven't written any code really that has anything to do with JSON or XML or any of that. That's all being provided by the framework right now, which is really cool. Let's do the same sort of thing, but not express an accept header. I'm just going to send a GET request to /people and not say anything about what kind of data I want to get back. And what I'm going to get back is HTML, right? This is what would happen in the browser if I sent a GET request to /people. So this HTML renders a table and looks nice in the browser, but it's not great for if a piece of software was going to send a request for a list of all the people. That software doesn't want this HTML, of course. It wants JSON or XML or something like that. So one way to get JSON back is to express that you want JSON in the in a request header. Another way to express that you want to get JSON back is at the end of the URL, I can express that. So the request now is not to /people, it's to /people.json. And then likewise, if I request people.xml, I get an XML representation of those same people. Does that make sense? Questions about any of that?
What does your controller look like right now?
It's the default generated scaffolded controller. So I can pull that up, but I've made no code changes to this controller. So Grails developers are generally familiar with the default scaffolded controller. But it would work exactly the same way. So the question was, yeah, the question is, if had I not generated this controller, but I had the controller here that just had one line in it, which is static scaffold equals true, if that was the only line in this in the controller and I deleted everything else, everything I'm talking about right now would still work exactly the same. Really, the what you get when you use dynamic scaffolding, which is what line 10 represents. So if I deleted everything after line 10, what line 10 says is dynamically generate this controller at runtime. And the behavior that that dynamically generated controller has is the same behavior that's represented in all of this code that was generated. So normally, you wouldn't generate this code unless you were going to change it. If you're not going to change it, don't generate it, right? All that code's just a liability. It's just more code for you to maintain. The reason you want to generate the code is you're going to use it as a starting point and then start evolving your controller to add whatever custom behaviors you need. But if the behavior that's in this generated code is what you want, then don't generate the code. Just have static scaffold equals true. Does that make sense? You were answering his question, right? Yep. Very good. You did it more efficiently than I did. All right. So we've expressed what we want. We want /people to be associated with a person controller, and all of these mappings get generated for us. So even with just that, we've got some pretty cool, compelling stuff for building RESTful interfaces. And it turns out this is really just the first 4% or something. There's a whole lot more that the framework does to help with this. So here are some examples of the kinds of interactions that I just did from the command line. Right, I can send a these are all get yeah these well the first one is a GET request. I send a GET request to /people. I get back a JSON representation of all of the people objects that are in the database. The second example is creating a person. So let's do some of that. We'll come out here. Let's open a browser up so we can, it's a little bit easier to look at some of this data. There's my person controller. So right now we've got three person objects in the database. So what I just now did was open a browser and sent a GET request to that same URL that we're interacting with from the command line. And there is no request header here that says give me JSON. So what we got back was HTML. This is the HTML that we saw in the console a moment ago. It's the exact same application, the exact same controller action is handling this request. It's the same action that's handling the request that I'm executing from the command line, which is good. Okay, we've got three people in the database right now. Let's create another one. That should work. I want to not have two people named Jake because those will be complicated to keep track of. Webster the dog is 9 years old. Is that all right? Okay, so I'm sending a post request to slash people. Again, the same URL. Send a post request there. That looks like it worked. If I come back here and refresh this, it did work. Right? So that's good. And one last thing we'll do is we'll update an existing person. So it looks like Zach's ID is 2. So I'm going to use that in this request. I just executed that command. Let's copy this. 2. If I clear this, it'll be easier to look at. All right, so I want to send a put request to update the person whose ID is 2. So /people/2 is the URL that I'm sending the request to, and 2 is the ID of the person that I want to update. And I don't want to set his first name to be Jacob. Tomorrow is Zach's birthday. Today he is 16. Tomorrow he will be 17. All right, so before I press enter there, let's go take a look here and see what we've got. Looks like Zach is 16 in the database right now. And I'm going to send this put request to update the person whose ID is 2. And I'm specifying a body for this request. The body has some JSON in it. That's this business right here. And I've expressed the content type of the body is application JSON. So when the request makes its way to the Grails app, Grails is going to look at this content type header and recognize that the content type is application /JSON, so it's going to parse the body, which is this, and it knows what to do with that. And that's when the data binding comes in, and we're going to talk more about the data binding in just a minute. Let's send that request. Looks like it worked. If I refresh this, there we go. We updated Zach's age, and he's now 17. The URL that I sent that request to is so RESTConf demo is the name of my app, is really /people/2. And if we come back to this table we were looking at a moment ago, the second one from the bottom is the one that we just executed. So we sent a request to /people/2 that executed the update action. There was a request header that expressed that the body contained JSON, so the framework knows how to parse the body, right? We used a different mechanism to parse JSON than we would use to parse XML, of course. So the framework knows that the body is supposed to be valid JSON. The JSON gets parsed, turned into something that we can use to do data binding. Then the ID value is used to send a query to the database to retrieve a person with a particular ID. In our case, it was Zach, right? So a query was sent to the database to retrieve Zach. That instance is now in memory, and we've got a reference to it. Data binding can be imposed on that instance, and the data binding source, the source of data that's being bound to that person object, is we can think of it as a map, right? It's a map, and the data in that map is whatever was in the body of the request. It was the JSON that I specified as the body of the request. So that particular JSON had a map where the key was age and the value was 17. So when the data binding happened, the age that was originally 16 is now updated to 17. The instance is persisted to the database, and we carry on. And all of that, again, remember, we really haven't written any REST code yet. All the code that we've written in our application is we've defined the person class that looks like this, and we generated a controller. And then I added the one line to our URL mappings file. That's all the code we've written so far. All right. Comments or questions about any of that? Yeah?
On a put or a delete, does the accept header make a difference?
The question is, on a put or a delete, does the accept header make a difference? And on a put it would, because you're updating an instance, right? So we've got to parse the body and know what to do. With a delete, that's not the case, and we'll see why that is. We'll see something coming up where we see what's really happening in your controller when you send a delete request. And one of the things that's not happening is data binding. There's no reason to do data binding just to delete an object. Does that make sense? Good. Anything else?
So I believe put and post would actually parse the JSON. And so if I send a post,
so the question is, if you send a post to /people/what? Okay, so the question is, what will happen if I send a request to /post/ I'm sorry, to /people /ID, and it's a post request. So,
yeah,
so we don't have a URL mapping for that. So if we did this, I'm going to change this to a post. And we got a 405 back, which is, and that's the HTTP response code for that's telling you, you sent a request to a URL that might be valid, but you used a request method that's not valid. So the, what did I do? I did a post to the save action. So the save action doesn't allow you to do that. And that's another thing we'll see coming up. We'll see some details around that. That's an important part of building these kinds of interfaces, is making sure that folks don't get to send certain kinds of request methods to actions that shouldn't allow those kinds of request methods. And the really simple one example of that to think about is delete requests, right? So the only HTTP request method that's valid for to access the delete action is a delete. The request method has to be delete. Imagine that wasn't the case. So right now, if you send a delete request to /people/2, it's a delete request to /people/2, what the framework's going to do is delete the person whose ID is 2. That's what you want. But if you could send a get request to people/2 and have that delete a person, there are all kinds of reasons that's a bad idea. What if Google cached that link and someone did a search and they click a link and now they've deleted data? So you shouldn't do anything destructive in your web app in response to a get request, and this is an example of that. Make sense? Yes, sir.
On that same kind of note, are you going to get into discussing kind of Grails way to handle to secure this kind of stuff? Or just
Yeah, the question is, are we going to talk about how to secure some of that? And we're not going to get really deep into security, but I am going to talk a little bit more about what I just now touched on. So we'll get back to that. And if we don't get deep enough to cover whatever it is you have in mind, we can take that up in the Q&A. All right, let's press on a little bit. So we've seen how all of this works. We've got several requests to the same URL, and the HTTP request method is causing different things to happen when that request makes its way into our application. So here is here's an example of a controller action, right? So this is inside of a controller. I've got an action named update, and the update action accepts a parameter of type person. So person is our domain class. And what you would probably want to do inside of this method is make sure that the request is a put request, right? Because I only want to allow updates in response to a put request. So you could have code inside of your controller action that says, if the request method is not a put, then this is no good. Send a 405 back and I'm not going to do anything else. If the request method is a put, then carry on with whatever's in the else block. We're going to go ahead and do the update and do whatever our application needs to do. But this is tedious, right? This is going to show up in lots and lots of controller actions, in lots of controllers. And because it's so tedious, people aren't going to do it. And now you've got issues in your application. So you don't have to do that if you use the allowed methods approach. And the way the allowed methods thing works is inside of a controller, you can declare a static property named allowed methods and assign it a value that is a map. And the keys in the map correspond to the names of actions in this controller, right? So save, update, and delete are examples of the names of actions that might be in this controller. The strings, the values that are associated with those keys in the map, represent the HTTP request methods that are acceptable for accessing that controller action. So what's expressed here, and by the way, this is the default one that's generated when you generate scaffolding. What's expressed here is only post requests may be used to access the save action, and only put requests may be used to access the update action, and only delete requests may be used to access the delete action. Not represented there, but another way that you can express some of this is the value in that map doesn't have to be a string. It could be a list. So you can do something like this. Let me wrap this around so we can see it all. So let's say there was some other action in here called foo, and I wanted it to be accessible via get requests, right? So that's perfectly valid, right? That says get request may be used to access the foo action. But if I wanted it to be accessible via gets, puts, and posts, as an example. I can do that. So the value associated with foo in the map is not a string, it's a list of strings. And the way that works is if the request method is any one of those, it's valid. And if it's not, it's invalid, right? So the what was here initially before I typed that, this is what's generated by default when you generate scaffolding. And a lot of folks don't really give it too much thought, right? They generate the scaffolding, it does the right thing, and they move on. But it's important to understand what's going on here, because often the reason you've generated this controller is you're going to add some more stuff to it. And if you add actions to this controller that modify your database, for example, you probably want to come back here and update this and express restrictions for your new controller actions that you've written. So again, the keys in this map correspond to the names of controller actions in this controller. The values associated with those keys represent the HTTP request methods which may be used to access those particular controller actions. Make sense? All right. So you don't have to do the imperative check that you see in the upper left here. So don't write code in your controller actions that says if request method is something, it's not something, send a 405. Don't do that. Let the framework do that for you. So another thing about this is, so the controller action is accepts a parameter. And in this case, the parameter is of type person. As of Grails 2, controller actions can accept parameters, and the parameter types that are supported all fall into one of two categories. The first category that we'll talk about there are 17 kind of core types that are supported by the framework. And that seems like a lot, but it's easy to remember. So there are 8 primitives defined by the language, right? There's byte, char, short, long, float, double, and whatever the other ones I missed, int, boolean, right? So you've got 8 primitive types. You've got the 8 type wrapper types. So int is the 32-bit primitive. java.lang.integer is its type wrapper. So all 8 of the primitive types have type wrappers. So now you've got 16 types. And then java.lang.string is the 17th. So all of those types are supported. So if you have a controller action that accepts a string parameter called foo, then before Grails executes your controller action, what it's going to do is it's going to go look for a request parameter named foo, and whatever the value of that request parameter is, that's what's going to be passed as an argument into your controller action. So you don't have to interact with the params directly, and you don't have to do type conversion. So if you had a parameter called foo as an argument to your controller action method, and its type was int, then what the framework's going to do is go grab the foo request parameter, convert it to an int, and pass that int as an argument into your controller action. So that's how the 17 kind of core types work. Any other type that you specify as an argument to a controller action is treated as a command object. And the way command objects work is represented here. So the method on top is what you write in your controller. You declare a controller action, and that controller action accepts a parameter of some type. If we go look at, this is our default generated scaffolding. Excuse me, and there are several examples of this in the default generated scaffolding, right? Here's the show action that accepts a person instance as an argument. Here's the save action that does the same thing, right? And edit and update and so forth. And you can write your own controller actions that accept parameters like this. So what the framework does with this, and this all happens at compile time. We've got a compiler extension that generates all this stuff that I'm about to describe. So it's not dynamic stuff happening at runtime. We're generating the code on your behalf at compile time. So you write an action like what you see up at the top. That is, you declare an action and express that it accepts a parameter of some type. And what the compiler generates is a no-arg version of that same method, so a method that does not accept an argument. So if you compile your Grails application and now go look at the bytecode using JavaP or a decompiler or whatever, you'll see that this method is in the bytecode, right? We've generated it on your behalf at compile time. So we generate a no-arg version of the same method, some controller action. The code that's inside that no-arg method, it does what you see here, right? We create an instance of the widget class. We do data binding on it. And then we do dependency injection, and that's more code that I wanted to represent in the slide here. But dependency injection happens. Then W is validated. then that instance of W is passed into your controller action. So remember, you've written the code at the top. You never see this code down here, but it's there at runtime. You've written the code at the top. So by the time your controller action executes, W has been initialized, data binding has happened to it, dependency injection has happened to it, it's been validated, and now you can do whatever you need to do with that instance of the widget class. A common thing to do is to interrogate it and ask it if it has errors, right? Because the widget class might have expressed some constraints, and you want to make sure that the bank account balance is greater than zero and the person's age is, you've expressed constraints about what the valid values in the widget class are. So often the first thing you want to do in some controller action there is say, if w.hasErrors, do one thing, else do another thing. But all of this has happened before the code that you've written executes. Does that make sense? If that argument is a domain class, some more interesting things happen, right? So here we've got some controller action that accepts a person object, and person is a domain class. So lots of special things happen to domain classes in a Grails app, of course, and this is an example of that. So the code represented at the bottom of the slide is kind of pseudocode representation of what's really going on. So let's step through this. First, we check to see if there is an ID request parameter. So when we sent a request to /people/2, 2 was the value of the ID request parameter. So we check to see if there's an ID request parameter. And if there is an ID request parameter, we send a request to the database, send a query to the database to retrieve the person whose ID matches that, right? So person.get, params.id, and now we've got an instance of person. If there is no ID request parameter, then there's no way to go look one up from the database. So we'll just create a new one, right? P equals new person. So when we get through this code on the left, all we've done so far is we've initialized P. It's either a brand new person instance that we've created, or it's an instance that we retrieved from the database. Then we carry on. So maybe we're going to do data binding. Maybe we're not, but maybe we are going to do data binding. We have to figure that out. So by default, we'll say we are going to do data binding. So def do binding equals true. That's what you see over on the right there. If there was an ID request parameter, what that means is P is going to be an instance that we retrieve from the database. So some care has to be taken to make sure we don't do data binding when we shouldn't, because we'll be modifying the database. So there's a check that says if there's a request parameter and the request method is not a patch, a post, or a put. If it's none of those, then we'll do data binding. Let's see, if it's not one of those, we won't do data binding. That's what's expressed there. So if the request method is not patch, post, or put, then we're not going to do data binding. So we fall past that first if block, and if do binding is true, then we do data binding. Otherwise, don't do data binding. Either way, dependency injection happens, then the thing is validated, and then it's passed as an argument to your controller action. So the question or comment is that this is the first mention of the patch HTTP request method, and how does that relate to this table we were looking at before? And it kind of doesn't relate to this table, because this table represents the mappings that are created as a result of this, and there is no patch mapping created as a result of that URL mapping. You could define your own mapping that says, if a patch request is sent to this URL, I want it to be handled by a certain action. You could also have a mapping that doesn't say anything at all about HTTP request methods. So any request to a certain URL goes to some controller action, and if that request happens to be a patch request, then this will come into play. What's important there is that we don't want to do data binding if the request method is not a patch, post, or put. Lots of applications don't monkey with patch anyway, but this is what the framework does. The framework will not do data binding to an instance that was retrieved from the database if the request method is not a patch, post, or put. Does that make sense? Anything else? All right, so then we carry on. If do binding is true, we do data binding, do dependency injection, validate the thing, and pass it into the controller action that that you had written. All right, so what we had to do to make all of that happen was not a whole lot, right? We had to write a domain class that looks like this, and we defined a URL mapping that looks like this, and I guess that's all we did. And everything else that we've discussed so far just worked. So that's not a whole lot of work, but it's a little bit. But it can be made even more simple than that. We can do all of this without even having a controller, right? So car is a domain class, and we've annotated that domain class with at resource, at grails.rest.resource. And a bunch of interesting things happen as a result of annotating a domain class with at resource. Without generating a car controller and without going into URL map, without doing anything else other than defining this domain class, we get the same URL mappings that we got in the previous scenario. We get the same controller behavior, all that same data binding and command object support, the same rendering support, which we haven't really looked at yet. We've seen the results of the rendering. We see JSON coming back and XML coming back. But we get all the same behavior from this approach that we got from the previous approach that I just looked at. So if we come back to our application here, we'll see, I think I've got a car class. Yeah, so I've got that same class that's represented in the slides there. This URI represents what you would guess, right? That says all requests to /automobiles should be, those are going to be REST requests for interacting with the cars that are in our database. So let's go look at my Bootstrap and see what I've got. So I've got two cars are being created, right? A Ford Fusion and a Chevy Equinox. Let's go back to the browser and see if we've got those cars. Yeah, so we're getting, notice we didn't get HTML, right? We got XML. And maybe that's what we want, and maybe that's not what we want. Maybe what we want is for the default, by default, I want to get JSON. And if somebody requests XML, then I'll give them XML. So let's see what it takes to make that happen. If we look at the source code for the resource annotation, so the resource annotation is part of Grails. It's an annotation provided by the framework. There is an attribute defined in the resource annotation called formats, and its default value is this list. It's XML and JSON. And if we want to turn that around and make JSON, the order here is important, by the way. The first one is what you'll get by default, and then the rest are the ones that are supported, but the first one is the one that you'll get by default. So if I want JSON to be the default, I can do this. I can say formats equals JSON and XML. And you know what, before I do that, let me get that out of there for a moment. I want to come back over here and we'll send a GET request. We won't specify anything about request headers. Let's see, get rid of that one as well. And get rid of the body. We'll just send a request to automobiles. Right, so we got an XML representation of the cars there is what we got back. If I ask for automobiles.json, I'll get JSON, right? And if I ask for automobiles.xml, I'll get XML, right? But what I want to focus on is what happens if I don't specify what I want. And right now we're getting XML. So let's come back here and specify that we want JSON to be the default. And I'll save that. I think I'll have to restart the app for that change. So I just stopped the app and I'm starting it back up. But so I'm providing a value for the formats attribute of the resource annotation, and I'm expressing in particular what I want to, what we're focusing on here, is that JSON is first in the list. So as soon as the app gets up and running, we'll send another request to this URL, and we should get JSON back, and we did. Right, so that's a change in behavior from what we saw a moment ago. If I explicitly ask for JSON, we'll get that. If I explicitly ask for XML, we'll get XML. And if I don't express what I want, we'll get whatever the default for that resource is. Right. So again, all the code that we've written so far is we've defined the car class, and I've expressed that the car class is a resource, is a REST resource. And I provided some information necessary for the framework to help accomplish what we want, right? I have to express the URI that is used to access these resources, and then optionally I can specify the formats supported for accessing this resource.
Can you still get HTML with
The question is, can you still get HTML with that? And you can. Stand by, we're going to come back to that as well.
So this resource can be applied only to classes under the main folder?
Yeah, so the resource annotation is applied to domain classes. The question is only classes under the domain folder, and I think that's right. I don't think you'll get away with applying the resource annotation to classes under Source Groovy, but now as I'm answering it, I'm not 100% sure. But typically it's used for domain classes because, there's too much behavior that wouldn't make sense for non-domain classes. Yeah. Yeah, so the resource annotation is for domain classes. All right. Yeah, another question? You can't. So the question is, what if you use multiple data sources? Can you still use the dynamically generated code? And you can. And this doesn't change any of that, right? So one of the things that the framework is doing is stuff like this, right? Person.get is here someplace, right here. P equals person.get. That doesn't say anything at all about what data source we're talking to, right? So separate from this, Grails provides a way for you to express what data source each of your domain classes is associated with. So by default, there's only one data source, and all of your GORM entities are associated with that data source. So there's a way to express that you've got three data sources, and these domain classes belong to that data source, and these domain classes belong to this data source. And there's a way to express all of that completely independent of REST, and this code would still look exactly the same, right? You'd still call person.get. And what get does is it sends a query to whatever data source the person class is associated with. You're going to get the default, the same thing as if you had written code that calls person.get, right? So if you've got the person class mapped to multiple data sources, if you call person.get, that'll go to the default data source. And if you want to go to anything other than the default data source, then you have to use the namespacing thing. So it's person dot, what is it? It's person dot data source name dot get, right? All of the magic stuff that we're talking about that's generated for you is going to go to the default data source because it's doing things like this, right? Person.get. It's as if you had written person.get yourself. Does that make sense? Any other comments before I move on? All right. All right. So responding. So far we've seen the results of we've sent requests to our application. Sometimes we get back XML. Sometimes we get back JSON. Sometimes we get back HTML. So inside of a controller action, we've got some pretty sophisticated and really slick to work with content negotiation stuff that's related to some of that. So inside of a controller action, you can do something like send a query to the database to retrieve all the person objects, and then invoke a method called withFormat and pass a closure as an argument. And the syntax here is inside of that closure, you're invoking methods whose name correspond to MIME types, right? So HTML, XML, and JSON, those are MIME types. If what this says is if the request wants HTML back, return a map. And if the request wants XML back, render this list of people as XML. And if the request wants JSON back, render the person list as JSON. Right? So let's go back to that first one, the HTML version. So when a controller action returns a map, what happens is Grails is going to render a view. And nowhere here is the view name specified. Right? So the view name will be list. It will be list because that's the name of the controller action. Whatever the name of the controller action is, that's the name of the view that will be rendered. And then when you render a view in Grails, optionally you can supply a model. And often you do supply a model. And the way to supply a model to your view is you construct a map and return that. One way to get the map to your view is return the map from your controller action. And that's effectively what's happening here. So this particular map only has one entry in it. The key is person list, and the value is people, which is whatever was returned from person.list. So, but that map can have as much stuff in it as you like, right? It's just a map of whatever needs to be passed into the view. The keys in that map correspond to variable names that can be referenced inside of your GSP. So if we've got a GSP called list.gsp, That list.gsp is what will be rendered for this HTML block inside the with format closure. And inside the list.gsp, if I refer to a variable named person list, the value of that variable will be people, which is whatever was returned from person.list at the top of this controller action. So we've got content negotiation stuff going on here, right? So I've got a closure that I've passed to the with format method, and that closure has sort of different cases for handling different kinds of requests, right? I can send JSON back, I can send XML back, or I can render HTML. The controller action you see at the bottom is the preferred way to do this as in recent versions of Grails. So you would do away with all of that code, and so you could just retrieve the people, right? Def people equals person.list, and then respond people. Where down here I'm responding with a particular person instance. So I can respond with one person, or I can respond with a list of persons. And that respond method is going to take care of the content negotiation stuff. So the respond method is going to look at the request and see if there is an accept header that expresses that it wants XML as an example. And if it does, if that request header does exist, then the result of calling respond and passing the person instance as an argument is that person instance will be rendered as XML, and that's what will be sent as the body of the response. If the request includes a header that says the accept header is application/JSON, the same sort of thing will happen, but the person instance will be rendered as JSON, right? But you've gotten rid of that not too terribly tedious code, but you've gotten rid of a bunch of code here, and you've expressed kind of more declaratively, here's a thing that I want to be part of the response, and I don't want to express anything right here in my controller action about how I want to represent that. Just respond with this thing, and then the respond method knows how to do things like render that thing as JSON, render it as XML, or render a GSP if that's what's appropriate. Yeah? The question is, do you have any control over the model passed to the GSP? Is that the question? You do. So you can pass the model as an optional argument to the respond method if you had just arbitrary other stuff that you wanted to put in the model. And if all you want to put in the model is this person instance, then you don't have to specify a model at all. It'll be there. Yep. Other questions? The question is, what if you want to cut down what is passed? So instead of getting, instead of getting all this, maybe I want some subset of that. Is that what we're talking about? So funny you should ask. Good question. That's a very good question. So I should have said something like, no, Grails just doesn't support it. That's crazy. We've got good stuff there. So. You can customize the renderers, right? The respond method is using some mechanism to turn that person object into JSON, or into XML. And by default, you get all the attributes that are in that class, right? So you see the class is demo.car, the ID is 1, the make is a Ford, the model is a Fusion. You get all the attributes of the class, and sometimes that's what you want, and sometimes that's not what you want. So you get to customize that. One way you can customize what's rendered is by registering renderers as spring beans in your resources.groovy file. So we're looking at the contents of the resources.groovy file in our application, and we're adding a bean whose name it could be anything. So people JSON renderer is the name of the bean here, but that's there's no convention at play there. It could be anything. The first argument to the people JSON renderer method there specifies the type of the renderer that I want to register. And there's a renderer called JSON collection renderer that's provided by Grails. You see the import statement at the top, so you see what package it's defined in. That's the default renderer that's used to render. Anytime you render a collection of anything as JSON, that's what's going to be used, the JSON collection renderer. And what we're expressing by registering this bean here is that anytime a person in particular, so the person is the second argument to the people JSON renderer. Anytime a collection of person objects in particular are rendered, use this renderer. And this renderer is being configured with some excludes, right? So that says excludes equals age. Let's see what this looks like. Let's send a request to get to get people, right? So when I send a request to /people.json, we get the JSON representation that looks just like this, right? And so the attributes that are being rendered there are the class, the ID, the age, first name, and last name. Let's come into our application here. Let me stop it. We'll look at our resources.groovy, and I'm going to uncomment this. The line that I just uncommented there is exactly what we were looking at in the slide. So we'll start this back up. So I've registered a bean just like that, right, in my application now. So right now the application's being rebuilt, Tomcat is being started up, and our application's being redeployed to that Tomcat. And as soon as that's up and running, we'll send this same request. And what we should see is the same data, but we won't see the age attribute because we've expressed that anytime, and it didn't wrap quite as prettily, but you see the age attribute is gone there, right? And that's represented here as well, for those of you who can't see the bottom of the slide there. Right, so now if I sent a request for all the people, this collection renderer is what was used to turn all of those person objects into JSON, and the age attribute is not represented there. So that's one way, there's more to this, but that's one way you can customize what's being rendered there. We're going to drill into this a little bit deeper, but questions before I press on here? No? All right. Another thing you can do is you can just, so back here we didn't really write our own renderer. We took advantage of a renderer provided by the framework, but we customized it a little bit, right? We just said exclude the age attribute anytime you're rendering a collection of persons. Another thing you can do is just write your own renderer, and you take total control over whatever's going to be made part of the response. So here's an example of doing that. So in this case, we've written a class called PersonXMLRenderer. And it extends abstract renderer, and again, you can see the import statements there to see where that class is defined. But abstract renderer is a class that's provided by the framework. It's a parameterized type, so person XML renderer extends abstract renderer of person, right? And that affects the argument type. This is the first argument to this method is parameterized, so it's person because we genericized our. When we expressed our parent class was abstract renderer, our parent class is really abstract renderer of person there. So when you extend abstract renderer, you need to do at least two things. One, you've got to provide a constructor that provides some information to the parent class constructor. One is the type of object that this renderer is used for, and the type is person. And the second argument to super there in our constructor is an array of MIME type. So in this case, we want the MIME type to be MIME type.xml or MIME type.text_xml. So anytime we're rendering a person and the MIME type is one of those two, it's either MIME type.xml or MIME type.text_xml. Anytime that's happening, Grails will use this as the renderer instead of the default renderer. So you've got to implement this render method. This is an abstract method in the parent class. So you've got to implement the render method. And two things are passed as an argument to the render method. One is the thing that's being rendered, so the person object in this case. And another is the render context. And the render context provides a few things. The thing that you're most often interested in when you're interacting with the render context is a writer. It's a java.io.writer. It's a thing you can write to. And you can just do writer.println, you can do really low-level stuff like that. More common is to take that writer and pass it to something something like the markup builder, right? So Groovy provides a class called groovy.xml.markupbuilder. You can pass a writer or an output stream. There are different arguments you can pass to the markup builder constructor. In this case, we're passing the writer that's associated with this render context to the markup builder. So now when I interact with that markup builder, the markup that is generating will be written to that writer, right? So I've constructed a new markup builder that's associated with the writer that I got from the render context, and then I can interact with that thing per normal Groovy markup builder stuff, right? So in this case, I'm calling xml.person, and I'm passing a map as an argument to that method. The map looks like it has three attributes, years old, first, and last. So let's see what some of that looks like. So this is what we're getting by default, right? And the attributes that are represented here are age, first name, and last name, right? Those names correspond to the actual property names in the domain class. Let's go back to our IDE and kill our app, and I'm gonna uncomment this. So I'm just adding another bean to our Spring application context. This time the bean is an instance of person XML renderer. And the source code for that is exactly what we just saw in the slides. It's the same class, looks just like this. Now, anytime I render a list of, let's see, that's not a list. Anytime I render a person and render it as XML, that renderer is going to be used. This is not going to use that renderer, right? Because this is not rendering a person. This is rendering a list of persons. We'll get back to that in just a minute. Let's go to people/2.xml. So now we're using the new renderer, right? Instead of age, we've got years old, and we've got first and last instead of first name and last name. That the markup that you see there really is coming from this renderer that we were just looking at, right? Come back here. Years old, first, and last. We'll change this. We'll make this number of years old, just so we see a change in the application there. That's starting back up. While that is starting back up, are there any questions or comments about what's going on in this renderer here? Right, so we've seen several examples of this, but interacting or participating in the REST stuff that Grails has to offer is almost always really simple, right? Whatever it is that you want to make happen, you can probably make it happen without too much work. So there, now we've got number of years old. So we get to customize exactly what that markup looks like.
So Eric. When it was returning a list, it defaulted to saying list if you wanted it to say people and then person. You just didn't write that code, I'm assuming. And it defaulted to list because it was a list return.
Yeah, so I'm not going to repeat the question, but I'm going to say some things that will basically accomplish the same task. So there are two kinds of renderers, right? There are renderers for instances and renderers for collections. So we've got, we've registered on line 8, we've registered or customized the collection renderer for persons. And on line 7, we registered a brand new renderer that we wrote for persons, an XML renderer. When you render an individual person, a renderer will be used, and when you render a list of persons or a list of anything, then a collection renderer will be used, and you can configure those completely independent of each other. And that's what we've done here. We've also crossed MIME types here. We've got a JSON one and an XML one. But if I wanted this same behavior that we're getting here for, so right now when you render an individual person, you get this. You're using our custom renderer. If I wanted that same behavior when I rendered a list of persons, then I would need to render a collection renderer for these guys, for the person class, that does the same thing that our instance renderer does. So it's not the case that the collection renderer is just delegating to the instance renderer. They're really two separate things that can be configured fully independent of each other. Does that address the question that you put together there? Okay, good. Other thoughts or comments about any of that? Yeah, so the question is, if you have a domain class that extends a parent class and you render an instance of the subclass, will the parent class attributes be there? Is that the question? And the answer is yes. So if you inherit properties and then render, so you've got a person class that has a first name, and then you've extended that with the employee class. So employee extends person. Person has first name, and employee has an employee number. So there are two attributes. One is inherited, and one is defined in the employee subclass. When you render an employee, you're going to get the first name and the employee number, unless you customize the rendering per what we're talking about here. So all the properties of an employee, including the ones that are inherited, are the properties that are going to be rendered. Yeah? The question is, are these renderers only used internally with Respond, or can you use them with as? And I don't think that we use them for as. Yeah, so the as type stuff is independent from the renderer mechanism that's built into the REST stuff that we're looking at. Other comments about that? It's good stuff. Right, so remember the way to register your renderers is you define a bean, add a bean to the Spring application context, That's of type JSON renderer or JSON collection renderer as examples. Here we're registering a bean that is the JSON collection renderer for persons. So anytime I render a collection of persons, this is the bean that will be used. And if I want to render register a custom renderer for particular instances, here's an example of doing that, right? So person XML renderer is the class that we just wrote here. And this is how we can register an instance of that renderer with, tell the framework to use that renderer. You simply put an instance of that class in the Spring application context. So one thing you don't have to do is every place in your application, all the controllers that might render persons, you never see, this is the only place you're gonna see person XML renderer mentioned, right? You don't have that showing up in lots of controllers. So later, if we decide we've got a different renderer we wanna use for persons, this is the only thing that has to change, is this, right? So all of your controllers just have code that looks something like this, right? Respond person instance, or respond with a list of persons. What's not expressed here, there's a lot of stuff that's not expressed here. One thing that's not expressed here is anything about representation, nothing about XML, JSON, none of that. We're just saying, here's the instance that I want to respond with. Another thing that's not represented here is how should I generate those various representations that I support, right? How do I generate that JSON, or how do I generate that XML? The framework will manage all of that for you. You have default renderers for collections and instances that are already provided, and if you want to customize them, what we've just talked about is how you go about doing a lot of that. So you end up with really clean, mostly declarative code, right? You're just saying respond person and leaving all the other details out of your controllers, which is good. One of the things that's happened, incidentally, over the years, if you look at Grails controllers from 1.3, and then look at Grails controllers from 2.0 and 2.1 and 2.2 and 2.3 and 2.4 all throughout the history, one of the things that happens is you're getting less and less code as time moves on, and more capabilities with that less code, which is great. And now, as you've seen in several demos, whole applications fit in tweets, right?
That's the new meme.
That's the new meme, right? All those tweetable apps, of course, are just goofy, hello worldly things, but they're demonstrating really powerful stuff that the framework's capable of, right? No one's pretending that you're gonna deploy real applications with this much code. All right, another option you've got when putting together RESTful services in a Grails application is we provide a controller called grails.rest.restfulcontroller, and it's genericized. So you can write a class like personController extends restfulController of person, and that parameter shows up in several places. When you have to provide a new argument constructor and pass the class reference to your superclass constructor. That's what's happening on line 8 there. And inside this controller, by default, what you would have is the same behaviors we've been talking about, the default scaffolded controllers for the most part. But you can participate, you can customize some of that behavior in interesting ways. So there's a method called query for resource that is defined in the RESTful controller class. You don't have to override it. By default, what it's going to do is basically it's going to call person.getID. But if you want to participate in querying for instances of persons for whatever reason, you get to do that, right? So there's code in the RESTful controller that when it needs to retrieve an instance of the person class, it calls, instead of calling person.get, it calls query for resource and passes the ID as an argument, and you can do whatever you want to do here, right? You get to construct the query and express, so maybe inside of this, instead of calling person.get, you want to interrogate something in the environment and based on that, decide which data source you want to send a query to. So you'd have some if blocks in here that says under certain circumstances, get the person from here, and under other circumstances, get the person from there. If for whatever reason you wanted to participate in retrieving the instances from the database, this is a way to do that. You can override the query for resource method. You are passed an ID as an argument, and it's your responsibility to come up with a person and return that. Right? And if all you're going to do is call person.get, then don't do this, right? That's what the parent class one is going to do effectively.
This would be a good spot where you can determine which of the two cases.
That's right. That's what I just described. So here you can do whatever arbitrary stuff you want. So you again, you could interrogate the environment, look for request parameters, or look for something that helps you decide where to send the query, and then use that information here. Get object to bind is a method that's also defined in RESTful controller, and you inherit that, but you can override that. And what get object to bind is about is when so when an update is happening, for example, the framework is going to retrieve an instance from the database. Let's see where we can get. Where is that example? Yeah, something like this is going to happen. So an instance—that's not a good example. All right, so forget that. I'll just describe it. So there are places in RESTful controller where an instance is retrieved from the database and data binding happens to it. Right, you're updating an instance, and by default, what happens is the instance is retrieved from the database. So something like person p equals person.get ID. So now we've got a person object that was retrieved from the database, and the next something like p.properties equals params. Happens. P.properties equals params, and that's a way to do data binding in your Grails controller. It's actually not p.properties equals params anymore. Now it's p.properties equals request, which is interesting. That opens up some more possibilities. When you use the request object as effectively the right-hand side of data binding, so let me back up. When you use the params as the right-hand side of data binding, what happens is the request parameters are the values that are going to be bound to your instance, right? When you use the request as the right-hand side of the data binding, so p.properties equals request, what will happen as a result of that is Grails is going to look at the request and see if it has a body, like if it has a JSON body or an XML body. And if it does, that's going to be parsed, and that's what's going to be used for data binding. So if your request has a JSON body and that has the data you want to bind to the instance, that this is how that happens. So the binding mechanism will look at the request, figure out if it's got a body. If it's got a body, that's what's going to be used for data binding. And if it doesn't have a body, then params will be used. Request.getParameters will be used. Right? So that's more flexible than saying p.properties equals params. A better idea is p.properties equals request. And then everything I just described will happen. The body will be used for binding if it's there. Yeah. So the question is, what if your body doesn't match the object? So you mean, as an example, the attributes don't correspond with each other?
Yeah, like let's say these dashes and the cases are different.
Yeah, so the cases are different and so forth. So the body of your request, and this is true even if you're not parsing the body. Everything I'm about to describe would also be true if you were using normal request parameters. So you're doing data binding, and the way the data binding system works by default is the thing that the data binding source, the map we'll just say, has keys in it, and those keys correspond to property names. So if you've got a person with a first name and a last name property, and you bind a map to it, and there's a key in that map called first name, the value of first name in the map is what's going to be bound, right? That's the normal happy path. And if there's other stuff in the map that doesn't correspond to properties in the domain class, they're of no effect, right? The data binding system just ignores them. So what if you've got a first name property in your person class and you've got a request parameter called first-name, right? And that's the scenario I think that maybe you were asking about, right? They don't match. So the data binding system doesn't know that first-name corresponds to first name, right? That it doesn't make any association between those two. You can participate in the data binding system. There are a number of ways you can go about this. You can annotate a property with an annotation called bind using. I don't have any examples of this in the slides or in the demo app here. It's not specifically tied to REST, but you do get to participate in the data binding process, and you can come up with arbitrary mappings. You can go through all the keys in the map, and for all of them that have a hyphen, then turn them into a camel case. And that's the sort of thing you might do here. Right, inside of this get object to bind method. So by default, in recent versions of Grails, what get object to bind returns is the request. Let's go here and look at RESTful controller, get object to bind. The request is what's returned by default. For most applications, that's what you want. You'll just orchestrate things so the parameter names correspond to property names and it all just works. But when you've got a situation where they don't match, that's one of the motivations or justifications for wanting to do this sort of thing. You want to override get object to bind. So now inside of get object to bind, you can look at the request parameters, do your conversions, create your own map if you like, and return that map. And that map is what's going to be used as the right-hand side of all the binding operations that we're talking about here. Yeah. Yeah, so the question is here around line 13 where we're calling person.where, if you wanted to access multiple tables, is that possible? Is that the question? Yeah, absolutely. But you, so you generally don't think about tables when you're using GORM to query the database. So inside of the where block, we might have things like ID equals ID and first name is not null, and we can express things like that. But one thing we don't express when you're writing a GORM query are things like table names and column names, right? That's the responsibility of the ORM tool to do that. So it could be that the person objects are really spanned across multiple tables, and the ORM tool is responsible for figuring all that out, right? There's another place where you express how you map your person class to the database, and that does not show up when you express queries. So when you call person.get and pass the number 2 as an argument, there's no mention of any table name there. You're just saying, get me the thing whose ID is that is this value that I'm passing as an argument. And the ORM tool knows how to turn that into a query that can be sent to the database. And it might not be a table at all, right? Maybe you're using some sort of document store. You're using MongoDB or something like that. So really, don't think in terms of tables and columns. Don't think in terms of relational databases, really, when you're constructing GORM queries. Think in terms of your object model. So the class name is person. It might be that the table name happens to be person as well, but the class name is person, and I'm expressing my query in terms of my object model, not my persistence model.
So would you do person.whatever
equals r.whatever? Yeah, so the way you would express the query, and we'll take a stab at this, and if this doesn't make sense, we'll press on, and I'm happy to take it up with you offline. But in your controller, you could do something like this. You could say person that where first name in Jeff and Jake, age is less than 98, right? So I'm expressing a query in terms of my object model, right? There's a first name attribute in the person class, and this is going to return all the persons whose first name is either Jeff or Jake, and their age is less than 98. How, so the comment is that only accesses person, and I submit that you don't know that, right? We can't tell from looking at this, and that's important, right? The what tables are being accessed are part of the mapping part of ORM. Someplace I've got to describe how to map person objects to the database. Yeah. So if the person has a car. You could say let's see. No, that's not how you do that. You say car.make equals Ford, right? So maybe that's accessing a different table, right? Maybe there's a, what if the person doesn't have a car? Then this criteria won't match. Yeah, you wouldn't say uppercase car, but we've wandered far enough off track. I'm happy to help you with this. No, don't apologize. I'm happy to help you with this, but let me go ahead and wrap things up, and I'll talk to you as long as you like about this. But I want to wrap up with the rest stuff. Yep. The question is, could you use filters to tap into the process and affect binding? So are you asking, thinking about things like the parameter name munging? Yeah, absolutely you could. So you could have a filter that, a before filter that gets executed before the controller action, and the filter can modify the params and do whatever you want to do there, yeah. Yep. Other comments or questions about any of that so far? So that is all the specific stuff that I wanted to cover, but I'm happy to address questions, more questions if there are any. Yeah?
With that last slide that you showed, here if you don't override us, you would have to override other methods, right, if you want to get the list, for example.
So the question is, if you don't override these, do you have to override something else to accomplish what, as an example?
To get the list.
So if you don't override anything, you're still going to get a list of persons. You'll get all the default behavior that we've been exercising so far. You only have to override methods like this if you want to steer away from whatever the default behavior is, right? So, and we've described several examples of that.
Does this RESTful controller also gives you the rendering
It does. All the same behavior that the default generated scaffolding controller, including those calls to respond that are content type aware, all the data bindings, all that behavior that we've been talking about is provided by the RESTful controller. And in addition to that, you get to do things like you see represented here. Yeah?
If I want to prevent binding a particular parameter, is that something that would do?
The question is, if I want to prevent binding of a particular parameter, is that something I would do? And then it tailored off. But whatever the end of that sentence is, I can fill in the blank there. When you define a domain class, by default, all of the persistent properties are bindable, right? So first name, last name, and age are all bindable. And maybe I've got some property here that for some reason I don't want to be bindable. I can say age, bindable, false, right? So what that says is anytime mass property data binding is happening to an instance of the person class, the age property is not bindable. That doesn't mean that I can't assign it a value. So if you've got code someplace that has a person reference and you say a per.age equals 9, that's going to happen. You've just assigned a value to that property. What this says is if you've got a map full of properties and you bind them to a person object and that map happens to include a value for age, age won't participate in that mass property binding. So this is a way to exclude things that you don't want to participate in that kind of mass property binding. Is that what you were getting at? Yep. So that's been, I don't remember what version of Grails we introduced the bindable business, but it's been there quite a while. Any reasonably recent version of Grails will support that. Yeah? If you override the binding behavior, does that apply is the question. And it would depend on in which ways you overrode the binding behavior. So for example, there is an annotation called bind using that you can apply to a and you can put a closure in here that does arbitrary stuff. But because you've said that the age property is not bindable, this will never be invoked, right? Because the code that's going to interact with that bind using annotation is further down the line. One of the first things that we do while we're iterating through this map during binding is we pull the entry out of the map and look at the key. And the key is age. And then we check to see, is age bindable? And if age is not bindable, then don't bother. We're not going to carry on. Yeah?
The rest information on the Grails in the Grails docs gets quickly into, nested endpoints. I don't even know if that's the proper term.
Yeah, that's a reasonable term.
But what's the best place to learn about how to, get car number two for person number one and do manipulation like that?
Yeah, so there's a comment and a question about, and I'm going to pull up the docs that you're referring to here, about nested resource mapping. Uh-oh, it may be that the Apple keynote is not over yet, and we can't, so I can't get to the internet. But you can express nested mappings really quickly. Consider this pseudocode that I'm about to write, because I might not get it exactly right. But you can do something like this. So we've said that the people resources are managed under /people. You can do something like, say, vehicles. What is the syntax? And then in here, you can say cars. Something like this. Something like that. So now URL mappings like /vehicles/id/cars/id. Is that the sort of thing that you're getting at? Yeah, so Grails has support for nested mappings like that. So the way you would request the cars that belong to a particular vehicle would be something like, I've used confusing names here. Let's do this. There we go. That's good enough. So if I want all the cars that belong to a certain vehicle, again, I've used bad names. But so we could send a request to /vehicles/4/cars. That's going to give me all the cars associated with the vehicle whose ID is 4. Does that make sense?
And does that happen automatically, or do you have to write the queries?
You do not have to write the queries. It happens automatically if you express this in your URL mappings.
Does your ORM model have to
I'll just say some things that will address the question. So the resource that's being managed by that controller, the vehicle controller, we'll just say that that's probably a vehicle resource. Whatever resource that is must have some of whatever resource this controller is managing. So we'll assume that the vehicle controller is managing vehicle entities and the car controller is managing car entities. This makes sense if a vehicle has many cars. Right. Yeah. The relationships between your domain classes, that's right. Yeah, so Ken points out that you can do the URL mappings report. And let's take a real quick look at that, and that will maybe be the last thing we've got time to look at. So if I run Grails. What was the comment?
Is it going up there?
Tomorrow morning, he's coming up here. So I ran a command called Grails URL mappings report, and I get this, right? And this is telling me all the URL mappings that are configured in my application. Some of these are from default mappings that don't have to do with the REST stuff we've been covering. But in particular, if you look here, this shows us, well, there is a patch mapping. I was wrong when I said that we didn't create a patch mapping earlier. So this shows us what all is configured in our application. So I can make some changes in my URL mappings file and then run this. And this is a. That is in 2.4. And it is, in fact, awesome. Did you have a question? No? Anything else? All right. Well, thank you all very much. If there's anything at all I can help you with, let me know.